Let's go straight to Lizzie Pearl in New Zealand, where families of the White Island volcano disaster have just been briefed on the recovery operation to finally get their loved ones back.
Well, New Zealand police are finalising a plan to retrieve the bodies of the volcano victims still on White Island tomorrow morning. Today is day three of an agonising wait for families here in Whakatane, including Australians. Today, they were given a full briefing by police on this operation before the plan was made public. It's believed eight bodies remain on White Island, most of them Australian victims following Monday's fatal eruption. New Zealand scientists have said there is further chance of another eruption on that island, making this recovery mission high risk.
The likelihood of an eruption has moved to 50 to 60% in the next 24 hours, up from 40 to 60% yesterday.
The official death toll from the White Island eruption remains at eight. Today, the latest Australian victims, Ben and Matthew Hollander, identified. They're in year 10 and year 8 at Knox Grammar School in Sydney. Ben, his school revealed, loved the outdoors and was passionate about baseball. Matthew was involved in cadets, also basketball and debating. The school community is devastated. Their parents, Martin and Barbara Hollander, are still missing. It's presumed they are still on the island, and it's hoped their remains, along with the other Australians, will be collected tomorrow morning.
And the Australians injured in this disaster have begun arriving home, where they'll undergo specialist treatment at hospitals across Sydney. Laura Tunstall reports on a new mercy mission that will bring more patients home tonight.
Well, the care flight jet is taking off here from Sydney Airport as part of efforts to bring injured New South Wales residents home from the White Island volcano tragedy. 10 New South Wales residents in total are being repatriated. Three arrived overnight at Concord Hospital, one at Royal North Shore. Three of them were brought in on a Globemaster aircraft with the Australian Defence Force. Two more patients are expected to be flown in today on a Hercules. They have all suffered from serious burns. This is very much a delicate medical operation to get them here, making sure they're comfortable and closely monitored for the flight. The care flight jet is expected to pick up two patients from Hutt Hospital in New Zealand and bring them back to the burns unit at Concord Hospital. We expect that that jet will arrive back tonight. There is a doctor and two critical care nurses on board that plane. We are expected to get an update from New South Wales Health on the condition of these patients later this afternoon.
Breaking news now, and Tiger star Josh Reynolds has been charged by New South Wales police with domestic violence. The West Tigers released a statement today confirming the former State of Origin player is vigorously defending the charges after allegedly attacking a 29-year-old woman, leaving her with bruising on her right arm and left leg. Reynolds has been granted conditional bail to appear at Sutherland Local Court. Angry Westpac shareholders have booed and heckled the chairman at the annual general meeting in Sydney today. It was clear that they did not approve after revelations the bank breached anti-money laundering laws 23 million times, possibly resulting in billions of dollars in fines. Nine's finance editor Ross Greenwood will have more on this story very shortly. Well, the bushfire fight from the skies is getting a multi-million dollar funding boost from the federal government as the Prime Minister faces fresh pressure on the link with climate change. Here's our federal politics reporter Fiona Willen.
There's been a change of tone from Scott Morrison today when it comes to climate change and bushfires. Now, he's been under a lot of pressure over this issue recently, including just yesterday when thousands of people rallied in Sydney. Just weeks ago when fires started in New South Wales and some raised questions about their link to climate change, well, the Prime Minister suggested there was a time and a place to debate controversial issues. But today he raised the topic himself. He was announcing an extra $11 million for more specialised aircraft to help with firefighting efforts when he acknowledged there were a number of factors contributing to the fires. But today he raised the topic himself. He acknowledged there were a number of factors contributing to the fires, mentioning the drought and the dryness, and he said climate change was a contributing factor. Let's hear a bit more of what he said.
Climate change is a global challenge. Australia is playing our role as part of this global challenge. That emissions from Australia are lower today than at any other time and than before we came to government.
The problem with the federal government is they don't have an energy policy, and that's why we are ranked at the Madrid conference 61 out of 61 countries.
The opposition leader was referring to a new global index that ranked Australia as the worst performing country on climate change policy. Now, when the PM was asked about it today, he said he completely rejected it, saying it was not credible.
Now to our correspondent Sophie Walsh in the UK, where there's been a final campaigning frenzy ahead of the crucial Brexit election.
If the latest polls are to be believed, Boris Johnson is on track to win the UK election with a small majority of about 28 seats. Having said that, they still can't rule out this all ending in another hung parliament. Boris Johnson was up at the crack of dawn in Yorkshire doing something that he hasn't managed to achieve since coming to office, actually delivering, although today he was delivering milk. He made the most of that photo opportunity until a journalist asked him to go live on TV for a TV interview. And well, he shied away.
Morning, Prime Minister. Will you come on? Good morning, Britain, Prime Minister.
Oh!
I just had a reaction here from one of the minders.
Well, in comparison, Jeremy Corbyn's last day on the campaign trail was relatively tame. He began it in Scotland, which is a key area he needs to win over if he has any chance of winning the election.
Tomorrow, let's go out there, please.
Polls open at 7 a.m, but weather is going to also be a major factor in this election. Voting isn't compulsory and snow is forecast for up north across Scotland. So many people are wondering whether people will be bothered to turn out to cast their vote. There's also a lot of people still, as we head to the polls, undecided. For them, this won't be a case of voting for who they like, but rather voting for the person they hate the least.